Here is the next free video from ITFreeTraining on special identities. Special identities in Windows exist on the local computer only and in some respects work like groups. In this video, I will look at how special identities work, how they are different from groups, and why they are needed at all. Once I have gone through all the special identities, I will then perform a demonstration on Windows 7 to see how to use these special identities. The special identities that I will look at in this video are listed here. If you only want to jump to information on a particular special identity, select the link here or in the description of the video. Unlike groups, membership of a special identity is determined by authentication or by the type of connection. Special identities exist on the local computer only. You may have noticed some of these special identities when looking at permissions in Windows. As shown here, the Everyone special identity is set as one of the permissions on this folder. If you have copied files between different computers, the permissions for these files are also copied. The question arises, how can this occur if special identities are local to the computer only? The way Windows allows permissions to be preserved when copying between different systems is that special identities always have the same SID. As shown here, the SID for the Everyone special identity is S110. Regardless of whether you copy the files to a workstation or server, Windows knows that this SID is always the Everyone special identity. Now that we understand the basics of how special identities work, let's now have a look at the default special identities included in Windows. The first one is Anonymous Logon, which allows a user to access a resource without a username and password. For example, if you had some files on a server that you wanted to make public, that is, available to everyone, you would assign permissions to the resource as Anonymous Logon. You can see that a traditional group would not work with this kind of access. You cannot know ahead of time which users are going to connect up to the server. It is also impractical to create user accounts for all these users. Imagine if you had a web server, and in order to grant access to the public documents on the server, you needed to create a username and password for everyone that required access. This is why you need special identities. The anonymous login works like this. When a connection comes into the computer and no username and password is supplied, this connection is classed as anonymous access. If the server is not configured to allow anonymous access, then the connection will be denied. If anonymous access has been configured, they are given access to any resources that have their permission set to anonymous. You can see that membership was determined by the authentication used on the connection. Since no username was given, the connection is classified as anonymous access. Now, all you need to do is configure the security on the resources that you want to give access to anonymous users by using the Anonymous Login special identity. In some cases, you may have a resource that you want to give access to users that have been authenticated and thus have a valid user account. The next special identity, Authenticated Users, allows you to do this. This contains any users that have been authenticated from any domain in the forest. If you have any external domains, that is, connected via a trust, users from these domains are also included in the authenticated user's special identity. The only authenticated user that this group does not include is the local guests on the computer. If you want to ensure that only users with a working user account have access to a resource, assign the resource the authenticated user's permission. The next special identity that I want to look at is Everyone. This includes everyone included in authenticated users, that is, all users from all trusted domains, and the built-in guest account. If you want to give access to everyone in the organization or from trusted external domains inside the organization, you would use Everyone. If you are using a system before Windows Server 2003, that is, Windows Server 2000 or Windows NT, Everyone also includes anonymous access. This is an important fact to remember if you have an old system. So far, the special identities that I have looked at have all worked off the way the user was authenticated. The next one that I will look at is interactive. Interactive is when the user is physically in front of the computer and logged in using any user account that allows them to log into the computer. It does not matter which domain it came from or which rights it has. As long as the account has enough rights to log on to the computer, it will be classified as interactive. Interactive also includes connections that are established using remote desktop. Since remote desktop gives the user much the same desktop control as if they were in front of the computer, it makes sense to include connections made using remote desktop in the interactive group. The last of the special identities is network. If a connection is made over the network, for example, to access a network share or perform remote administration, the user is automatically added to the network special identity. You can see that by using special identities, this gives you a lot more control than you would have using groups alone. Groups allow you to organize users, but there is no way to use groups to divide users up based on how they were authenticated and how they are accessing the computer. I will now change to my Windows 7 computer to look at how to use special identities. In this demonstration, I will create a folder that can only be accessed if the user is logged into the computer, either locally or using remote desktop connection. If the files are attempted to be accessed over a network share, for example, permission to the files will be denied. First of all, I will open Windows Explorer from the Quick Launch Bar. In the root directory of the C drive, I will create a folder called Data. To change the permissions of the folder, right-click it and select Properties. From the properties of the folder, select the tab Security. In the Security tab, notice at the bottom that all the ticks for permissions are in gray. This basically means that these permissions are inherited from the folder above it. Before I can change the permissions for this folder, I need to switch inheritance off for the folder. To do this, press the button at the bottom called Advanced. This dialog will only show the current permissions. In order to change the permissions, press the button at the bottom, Change Permissions. Now I will need to untick the option at the bottom, Include Inheritable Permission from the Object's Parent. Once unticked, I will need to determine which permissions will be used since the previously inherited permissions will no longer be inherited and thus will no longer be applied to the folder. In this case, I will select Add so the previously used inheritance permissions will copy to the folder. If I now exit out of these screens and go back to the properties, notice now that the ticks are black rather than gray and thus are not inherited and can be edited. Notice at the top the permission Authenticated Users. This is one of the special identities. This will allow any user that accesses the computer locally or from remote to have access to the files. For this reason, I will remove this permission. The group Users also has access. The Users group will contain domain users and also local users on this computer. With the Authenticated Users removed, users can still get access via the Users group, so this will need to be removed as well. Currently, only administrators and the system will have access to this folder, so I need to add some additional permissions by pressing Add. I am only trying to prevent regular users accessing the files over the network. Administrators in the system can still have access. Special identities exist only on the local computer, and by default, Windows will search for groups and users on the domain and thus will not find any special identities. To change this, press the button Locations. From Locations, select the local computer, in this case WS1. If I type Interactive, Windows will find the special identity Interactive and it will be added to the permission list. To ensure that interactive users can change files, make sure Modify is ticked. Now all users that log in locally to the computer will be able to modify files in this folder. These files will not be accessible from the network, for example, via a network share, because the user is not accessing the computer locally. This brings up an important NTFS troubleshooting tip. When setting permissions for groups like users and domain users, check to ensure that they are not getting access from a special identity. Removing the users group, as I have shown, does not stop users from accessing the files because they can still get access through special identities like interactive and authenticated users. Let's review what we have learned. First, are special identities available to every computer in the domain? This is a bit of a trick question. Special identities are available on all computers, regardless of whether they are in the domain or not. The point to remember with a special identity is the scope the special identity can be used is limited to that computer and only that computer. All Windows computers have the same special identities, which can be used locally on that computer only. The next question is, could a domain user access a folder that is set with only anonymous logon permissions? The answer to this one is no. Remember that you are automatically made a member of an identity if you meet the criteria. An anonymous user is one that does not have a username and password. If a username and password is given, then you are not an anonymous user. Of course, the domain user could connect without giving a username and password and get access that way. Thanks once again for watching another free video from IT Free Training. In the next video, I will start looking at a strategy for using groups called AGDLP. Now that all the theory on groups is done, we can finally start looking at how to use groups in your organization. See you next time.